my lecture is actually a very quick question to you. So this is the lecture. How can you make people be guided by Islam? How can you here be shuhada ala nas? And what do you think you need, and why aren't you doing that? Why do you think there are problems, whether with us as Muslim community or with our understanding perhaps of Islam, that is perhaps hindering us from being shuhada ala nas? I read about the great history of Muslims in India, and I see that there were times when Muslims, they were minority, but they were shuhada ala nas. Not necessarily governing in the political sense. Well, it happened in the past. But even if you don't govern in the political sense, you could still be shuhada. You could still be in the English language would be like the moral example and the example of al-khayr that the brother read in the same ayah, in the same hadith, that talk about that. Muslims have to be an example by being moderate, being wasati, and being balanced. And so this is what I understand from the verse. And my question to you, and this is the lecture, why aren't you doing that? And what do you think you need to do in order for Muslims to be shuhada ala nas? وَكَذَلِكَ جَعْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا لِتَكُونُوا شُهَدَاءَ عَلَى النَّاسِ. So that's it. Please answer the question and therefore ask me if you feel that there is something that you need my opinion for in this. Again, the question is why are Muslims in India not shuhada ala nas, really? They are not a guiding light to people, and they are not the moral example to people, perhaps. Maybe they are, maybe, I don't know. And how can they be that? And what is in Islam that is perhaps hindering you from doing that, or encouraging you, or what is the problem here? أين الخلل, you know, where is the problem? So please, open discussion.
So it's like in India, it's a secular state.
Okay.
So that's a big problem.
Okay. Okay, so in India, it's a secular state, and therefore, is it good or bad?
No, that's good. That's all fine.
Okay.
The problem is that there's people around there. In India, they think that Islam is an extremist religion.
Okay.
So that's the problem we got spreading.
Okay, so they think that Islam is an extremism religion, but is it an extremism religion?
Not at all.
Okay, so how come they think like that?
They have their own assumptions about their own religion. So they practice that, their own religion, they practice their own religion. Like spreading it, it's been tough because they have, we call it fitna, we call it fitna. There is a fitna, we call it, if we say something to them, so I say the image of Islam, the image of the people who are Muslims are not good in front of them.
Okay.
So that's the problem with them.
Do you think that this image of Islam, we Muslims present it to them, or do you think that they are lying 100%?
No, we present it to them.
Okay.
Because we've been lacking in education, we've been lacking a lot of things, so that's...
Okay, I agree, by the way. I've been visiting India, by the way, the past several years, every year, and I've been reading development reports. I'm not coming from a development perspective, but just to know the reality. And I have read that in terms of education, as you put it, in terms of healthcare, in terms of many things, I know that the system has its challenges, but I have read that Muslims are not giving a very good example when it comes to education. I lived across the Atlantic in Canada, and I went to the States many times. I'm familiar with America and Canada for that matter. But there are minorities in America that they call elite minorities, like the Jewish minority, for example. It is a small minority. The number of Jews in America are much less than the number of Muslims. But you find that Jews in America are an elite minority. They are very respected. Their religion is respected. They do whatever they want in Washington, and so forth. So why aren't Muslims in India an elite minority that does whatever they want in Delhi, and they are respected? Is part of it our fault, do you think? Or, Thank you. I'm just trying to.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah, please.
I will tell you one thing. There is a reason behind it in India.
Okay.
In India, you can see that every person is very busy in his business and another works. So, there is no person, there are some persons who have time to spread the Islam, only some people, not only every Muslim. So it is the reason behind it, big reason behind it, that the condition of Muslims in India are not good.
Yeah.
So, because they are busy in their businesses, not spreading Islam.
But
this is the big reason. We can see in every state that business is going on very high level.
But is spreading Islam, like, of course it is an objective. It is very important to call people for La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah.
Yeah.
But is this the only objective from being Muslim? Like, what I'm saying is, like, we have a responsibility to make da'wah ila Allah. The Quran says, قُلْ هَذِي سَبِيلِي أَدْعُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ. I call people to Allah. But also Quran says, وَلْتَكُمْ مِنْكُمْ أُمَّةٌ يَدْعُونَ إِلَى الْخَيْرِ. The other verse says, make da'wah to good. You see what I mean? Like, in Islam, we have two da'wahs here. Da'wah ila Allah, call people to Allah, and da'wah ila al-khayr, to call people to good. This is also Islam. So what I'm saying is, it is good to make da'wah for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for people to convert, to become Muslim. But it is also important and an obligation and a fard to make da'wah ila al-khayr, to call people to good. And good is not necessarily la ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. Good could be to call for charity. For, you know, I was stopped by some small kids, and I really felt so bad for, like, all of these street children. We have the same problem in Cairo. It's not only Delhi. Every big city has that. But I questioned, why aren't Muslims doing something for these street children? They might be Hindu. Well, they are children anyway, but they might be from Hindu parents or nothing parents. But they are souls. They are people. Why aren't we, as Muslims, do something for these children? There's so much khayr that could be done, and that we could make da'wah for the khayr, not just da'wah ila Allah, with the da'wah ila Allah. So if we put a da'wah ila Allah as one objective, I'm glad I have this. I have to practice being there. Sorry.
I have to practice being a teacher.
You can be there, right? So if we can do both, in fact, we can do both. If we can do a da'wah ila Allah and a da'wah ila al-khayr at the same time, perhaps then we can make da'wah ila Allah better, because the elite minorities, they do da'wah ila al-khayr. They educate people. You know, again, back to the Jewish minority in America. The Jewish minorities in America is not just doing corruption and lobbying in Washington, and it's not just that. They are the professors in universities. In fact, they are the best professors. I've been to many universities in North America and in Europe, and you find that the Jewish professor is a very good professor. Tons of books, very good students, and then the professor takes care of his or her students. They are the top media people. They work in media, in journalism. Sometimes they do unethical things, you know, like, you know, the Sunday Times, for example, and all of these pictures that they publish in the UK. It's true. But you cannot deny that this minority, small minority, is very influential in the media, not necessarily in bad ways, not necessarily in corruption and publishing, you know, bad pictures, but also by contributing to knowledge and contributing to media and contributing to the economy. I know that Allah mentioned that in the Quran, you know, many of our Jewish brothers and sisters do usury, riba. أخذهم الربا وقدرهم عنه وأكلهم ولا الناس بالباطل. The Quran mentioned this in a dozen places. It is true, but their economic excellence is not just because of usury. It is because of smartness with money and knowing where to invest. So if you're talking about the da'wah ila al-khayr, da'wah ila al-khayr is education, is media, is investment. Why are Muslims not being part of the Indian economy? It's a huge economy. And we, in the, whether in the Arab world or even in the West, we rely on the Indian economy in many ways, and the Indian you know, human resources. Every time I call, when I used to live in London, every time I call my bank across the street, somebody in India answers me for my account. And I can see my branch across the street. But when I call, the person who's in control of my account is somewhere, I don't know, Chennai or Bombay. And sometimes I joke with, where are you? He said, in Chennai, okay. But I'm calling HSBC across the street. He said, no. So what I'm saying is, India has a lot to offer. In, if we put it this way.
Hi, if we say education and economy, and media, I don't know, we can say public health, we can go on.
Al-Khayr in Islam, in the Usul, is defined as Maqasid al-Sharia, which is something I write about, my brother mentioned, and I understand that the Majma' al-Fiqhi brought some books, alhamdulillah. Each of you could take a copy, inshallah, in Urdu, one of my humble books translated. In Maqasid al-Sharia, we define Al-Khayr, or scholars, of course, like in Islam and across history, it's not just a new thing. Al-Khayr is defined as حفظ الدين والعقل والنفس والعرض والمال, the preservation of faith, the preservation of mind, and of and nafs, soul, preservation of life. Life is a better translation of nafs. So the preservation of life, the preservation of mind, the preservation of offspring, or children, or family, that's a better translation, and the preservation of wealth. So if education, economy, media, public health, this is the new names of al-maslaha, or al-khayr. The old names are the mind,
and soul, let's say life, and offspring, or let's say family, and wealth, or the man, let's say, economy. I know that the translation is very rough. Mind, intellect, education. So what I'm saying is, these are Islamic values that we have in our Sharia.
The Sharia is about education, and about life, and about family. Of course, after faith, Tawheed is the cornerstone of Sharia. But then Sharia is not only Tawheed. Otherwise, the Prophet ﷺ would say, قُلُوا لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ مُحَمَّدُ رَسُولُ اللَّهُ تُفْلِحُ, which he said. But he did not only say that. He said many, many other things about health and about birds and about wars and peace and about neighbors, about family, about many, many, many things. And we as Muslims, even if we cannot convey لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله, perhaps we can convey many other things. الدعوة إلى الخير. الدعوة إلى الله is there. Anyway, and I understand also, when I visited several of the people who work in fatwa and all of that, I understand that people convert to Islam. They do. And they have all of these fatwas, what do they do about, you know, the Hindu practices after they convert to Islam in terms of family and terms. So I understand that there is a conversion to Islam that is happening. But that is not the only role of Muslims, being shuhada' ala nas. Shuhada' ala nas is not only for conversion. Shuhada' ala nas is for al-khayr. The Prophet ﷺ was part of many initiatives in Mecca and in Medina and then in Arabia. And the initiatives sometimes were not for La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. It is for security. Sahifa al-Madina, for example, Hilf al-Fudud. And you know all of this about the seerah of the Prophet ﷺ. He was involved in many things for al-khayr, you know, for paying the people's debts. Remember Hilf al-Fudud and all of that. Or for alleviating poverty, or that other initiative for alleviating illiteracy. Remember, after Badr. And many initiatives, the Prophet ﷺ, even though he was the Prophet of Islam and the final Prophet for all times, he was also involved in education and in health and in family and in financial things and in the market.